one black man pulled over more than 70 times in one jurisdiction. I kid you not, this is just insanity. Let's put up the picture of this black male in Massachusetts. He is now suing the local police department, the Worcester Police Department, for racial profiling after allegedly being pulled over more than 70 times in the past 8 years. TJ Juty says he has been suspected of stealing cars. He has been suspected of selling drugs before even being apprehended with a warrant. The report says he was pulled over in 2021 for not updating his new car color on his registration. I need you to understand how petty that is. He got his car painted, okay? He did not inform registration that his car was painted. So they went ahead and, you know, threw the book at him. There's more. However, by law, he wasn't required to. But instead, Juty was charged with disorderly conduct and interfering with a police officer after an intense exchange. They're wrong on the law. He knows they're wrong on the law. There's an argument. Well, let's lock him up for arguing with us. How dare he? I feel like every single time, he says, even if I'm not driving and I make eye contact or an officer sees my dreads or sees I'm black, they're going to come after me. I just know whenever they're coming now, I just have my phone ready to record, he told GBH. Keep in mind, that's part of the reason for this kind of massive intimidation. The man is saying he's afraid to look them in the eye. Remember, there was a time you could not look a white man in the eye. And whoa, if you look at a white woman at all. You see, this is the permeation of that. Once again, contextualized in Massachusetts in this jurisdiction. I got more. Massachusetts has long been suspected of engaging in discriminatory activity against black and brown people. Just last year, the Department of Justice launched an investigation into claims of excessive force and racially biased policing. A statewide study from the Massachusetts Executive Office of Public Safety and Security found no evidence to suggest black drivers are more likely to get pulled over. The bulk of their methodology came from a veil of darkness analysis, which concluded non-white drivers were less likely to be stopped by police, but during the day when an officer could determine their race. The previous studies that found black drivers were in fact more likely to be stopped or have their vehicle searched were practically disregarded. According to GBH, the city of Worcester paid up to $5 million to settle lawsuits alleging false arrest and excessive force since 2006. Okay, that should defund the police right there. You see, police don't mind when the police defund each other. Typically, conservatives are not concerned when the police are defunding the police. But when there's a rally, press conference, I don't know, maybe even a social media post that says hashtag defund the police, all of a sudden, conservatives go wild. You see, defunding the police doesn't mean to eliminate the policing budget. It simply means to reprioritize it to actually fight real crime. Do you think pulling over people in this manner, creating lawsuits after lawsuits, do you really think that's giving you a win in that local community? There's more. The chief, let's put him up. Buck stops with him. The chief is Stephen M. Sargent, runs the Worcester Police Department. Department spokesperson said that per policy, the department does not comment on pending litigation. Here's the problem with that comment to the Worcester Police Department. The inquiry is general. Generally, do you all pull over more black people than anybody else? That's not a specific relation to a particular case. We're talking about statistical data that should be readily available to all citizens without the hand in glove relationship you have with the state. All right. Rick, thoughts?
Sure. So, first off, I agree with you about defunding, but we need to be very clear about this. And I've said this on plenty of videos when I've covered the intersection of sports and politics at TYD Sports. It's that if we were to have these settlements, it should come out of the police departments. And it should come out of the policeman or policewoman's pay. It should not come from us. Because when someone sues, which I think they're totally entitled to when there's false imprisonment, you know, wrongfully detained, blah, blah, blah. It should not come from the taxpayers, because then I think like, oh, well, how much are we gonna have to pay for this? When really it should be rerouted to the unions who have endless power, political control, placing certain people in different positions where they will remain immune. Qualified immunity is another thing that should be completely disbanded. But when you're going over the statistics of this case, this is an egregious example. But the problem is there are many egregious examples in this country of people who are not white getting pulled over. I'm glad that you brought up the investigation about the thin veil of darkness, 5 to 10% drop at night. The statistics prove it. Also on top of this, there was a University of Stanford study that showed over 60%, I believe it was 63 to 66% of black drivers were treated differently verbally as opposed to white drivers. So they were mistreated physically, 61%. They were mistreated physically, they were mistreated verbally. And I see all these examples of, and I know some folks hate saying this, but white privilege. Let me tell you something. I drove, this is wrong, I drove in California when I was first out here, my first stint, without a California's driver's license for like 3 years. Why? Because I like weirdly felt like it would be the most minor thing. That is minor in the grand scheme of things. So there are many different things. One of them that I found is a person named Brima Fofana, who in 2012 was falsely arrested by this same police department, suspected of drug transactions, dragged from his car, no drugs were present, claimed he tried to run, they claim he tried to run over a police officer. The lawyers got surveillance footage from a neighboring building. And of course, nothing ended up happening because he shouldn't have been charged in the first place. Another very important part, and then I'll wrap, is when different media outlets will just, without even looking into it, print a police statement.
Yep.
You know, in this case and in the case that we just brought previously, they will falsify because they know, getting back to the root of all of this, if they lie, there is incentive to lie, but if they lie, it's not gonna come out of their pocket. If they're proven wrong, it's gonna come out of your pocket. And that's something that needs to change.
You make such a great point about the privilege dynamic. There's a book coming out written by a journalist named Crystal Bowie, who's an investigative journalist. She was in Minnesota during the time of the George Floyd murder. And in this book, I was fortunate to get an advanced copy of it. In this book, she actually highlights how their news station decided to basically run the police report verbatim.
Oh my.
What allegedly happened George Floyd. Just ran it verbatim. Did not ask any questions, no nuance, no check at all. Naturally, they had to run it back after the video came out. But when pressed about it, the spokesperson for the police department said, oh, well, no, I didn't watch video. I just sent out the press release. Well, who told you the information? Well, the cops told him the information. And we have to check these narratives because there was a time when all law enforcement got a pass. Please understand, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not anti-cop, I'm only anti-bad cop. And you should be anti-bad cop too, because they're taking advantage of the good faith you have in them. They don't deserve it blindly, period, obviously.